去找。
要不然我们去一中那边。
打开。你找的东西
吗？我那是我的，那是我的地方。我可以带你。
而且一中我们在找考试的地方，考试也是我的地方。
那不是他地儿吗？妈还有人在一
起。好，现在结束。
你买二手？说好对。二手多少？
我
就是。那这个时候现在，那这玩意儿是有
用？现在是什么？
我心情跟他们用过的，全部是假的。
All right. So, take a few minutes. There's a sample stepping problem on the slide. See if you can evaluate that function on a piece of paper by drawing each of the steps, and make sure you don't skip any. You can take a few minutes. You can work together. It's up to you.
老师，
All right. So, for this little expression here, what is the first step going to be? What's the first part of it we're going to evaluate? Yep.
Multiply
9 and 3, you're absolutely right. The reason why we have to multiply 9 and 3 first is we start on the left, and we see check expect. Remember in Racket, you can only actually apply the functions to values, not to expressions. And the first argument to check expect is actually an expression, so we need to turn it into a value. Then we look at the plus operator's arguments, making our way towards the right. And we see that, oh wait, its arguments are also not values. And then we get max. Now, max's first two arguments are values, but the third is not. So we're going to have to evaluate that one first. So always make sure that you're using the correct notation for the steps and that you're only evaluating one per line. I guess I've actually forgot. Oh no, I didn't forget to write anything. I thought I had. All right. All right. What's the next step that we evaluate?
Apply the max.
Yep. Somebody different this time. What's the next step? Yep.
Remainder 5-2.
That's exactly right. And the next step. The addition?
Division of
27 plus. Yep. Sorry, I thought you said division.
No, division.
And of course from here, now this would normally in Racket, it would say, hey, test passed, all systems good. Where instead I'm going to write, this is going to evaluate to true because we expect 28 to equal 28. If 28 is not equal 28, then there's something wrong with your universe. All right, any question about these steps? All right. Before we get back to the slides where we left off, just a couple things I wanted to make note of. First off, if you haven't submitted assignment zero, I know the deadline has passed, but you can still submit assignment zero, and you need to submit assignment zero. So if you have just signed into this class, you're not excused from A0. Do it now. You have to get perfect on it, or you will not get a grade on an assignment until you do. So if you haven't already done A0, please do A0. It's really like register your clicker, put your name on some stuff, and tell us what program you're in. Nothing complicated. And of course, then there's A1, which is due next week, and you have everything you need in order to do A1. And if you're wondering whether you need the design recipe for assignment one, you do not need the design recipe for assignment one. Does that mean we are not going to judge you on style? No, actually, we are going to be looking at your programming style, so making sure that you have appropriate variable names and appropriate constant names and so on and so forth. We're going to make sure that you've defined appropriate constants and that your indentation looks nice and so on, but the design recipe itself is not required for assignment one, and it's the only assignment where that is true. All assignments after one require the design recipe, so do keep that in mind. All right, so a little bit more review. I've got the clicker working again here today. So last class we were talking about the design recipe. And one of the biggest parts of the design recipe is the contract. Now, this is something that doesn't appear in other programming languages, because other programming languages, especially statically typed programming languages, it's very obvious from the code what the types of the arguments are and the type of the produced value will be. But in a dynamically typed language like Racket, it's not obvious what the parameters to a function should be. So a random user may try to pass the add function a peanut butter jam sandwich and a string because you haven't told them what they should pass. So the contract is important to communicate with your user to make sure they know how the function should be used appropriately. We are very, very fussy about the format of a contract. So we have a function that consumes two natural numbers and produces an irrational number. What should the contract be?
Are you going to upload these questions online?
Am I going to upload these questions online? No, but they're technically in the videos. All right, I'll give you until 2 minutes have passed. If you're not sure what the answer should be, you should still click a button. Because you get one mark for a wrong answer. One mark is better than no marks, right? All right. Let's see what you have voted on. The majority of you have voted on A. A is correct, by the way. We are very fussy about this. So natural numbers, we short to nat. And you may think A, B, and C are all equivalent to each other, but they're not. The capitalization is different. And I have seen students lose marks on both exams and on assignments for having the wrong capitalization in their contract. Make sure you get it right. The first letter is capitalized in that, and the others are lowercase. So I never see this. People do angry, all caps, I'm yelling the contract at you. Although that is kind of funny. nobody does that. What I usually see that causes people to lose marks is they don't put any capitals in it at all. Read over the notes, read over the style guide. It'll show you how to write these appropriately. So, consumes two nats and is going to produce an irrational number. Now, some of you might have thought that it was this one here because the produced value is real. Well, in this course, we don't use that as a type. We use num for number to represent any real number, rational or irrational. So the correct answer is A. Any questions about these contracts? Fairy back corner, speak up.
if it produces an irrational number, what would you put?
If it produces an irrational one? An imaginary number. I don't think we've ever actually done that in this course, so I'm not sure we have a type for that. Let me double check our style guides to see if we've specified a type for that. And if we haven't, what I would probably write is imaginary as the type. But I honestly don't think we've ever had a question in this course about that. Would you like some imaginary number questions on assignments? Some of you are saying yes. No, that's too much work. All right, so let's do another one then. So part of the design recipe, but specifically for contracts, we note that sometimes the contract isn't enough to tell our users how we want them to call the function. For example, we might actually want them to give us a number, but that number has to be greater than or equal to zero. We don't have the ability in the contract to give that clarification. So under those circumstances, we need a requires statement. So think about if you were to write a function that takes things like the assignment marks and your final exam marks and the weights of each of those components as the arguments, are there any requirements that we might have on those arguments in addition to the contract? Yeah. I'll give you about 14 more seconds here. Again, it's better to click in than not. All right. So, almost everybody said E. E is correct. If you think about it, looking at these different options that we have here, the assignments have a weight, and the exams have a weight, and your participation marks have a weight. Does it make sense to have a negative weight? Do you want doing assignments to count against your final grade? Do you want showing up to the exam to cause you to fail simply by showing up? Even if you got 100%, that doesn't make sense. So obviously, we are requiring that the weights are greater than or equal to zero. Likewise, your score on each of those components should be greater than or equal to zero. How do you get a negative mark on the exam? Complex number that doesn't exist in the real world? That would be an interesting final exam grade. To be fair, I've had negative marks on exams before. CS251, if you didn't answer the question, you got zero on it. If you answered it and you got it right, you did get marks. And if you answered it and you got it wrong, it was negative marks. We're talking like 20 years ago. But in reality, we don't do that. And so the scores for each component needs to be greater than or equal to zero. Another one is the sum of the weights has to be equal to one. If you get 100% on the assignments and 100% in participation and 100% on the exams, you should get 100% in the course. But if the weights don't sum to one, then you would not get 100% in the course. So the answer is E because it's all of those ones above it. All right, any questions about this one? Right. So we finished talking about the design recipe, and I know for many of you, it always seems like it's a lot of effort to go through writing the design recipe out. Remember that you're not just writing the design recipe for marks. Yes, the design recipe is worth a significant part of your assignment marks from A to out. You are writing that design recipe, though, to communicate what your program does to users and to yourself in the future, exactly what it does, exactly the kinds of behaviors to expect from it, and you're also putting down all of those lovely test cases, not only to convince yourself that the program works,
but to convince anyone who uses your program that it actually works. So that if they make some kind of fix to it or change to it, they can know whether they have broken the intended original behavior or not. So that design recipe, while that may seem like a lot of work for two lines of code, it's actually really, really important. And it's not just something you're going to do in this course. If you go out into industry, they have software requirements, specification documents, and those can be hundreds of pages long. Just to write a 10-line function. Do it, at least for marks, please. All right, now where we left off last class, we were looking at other types. So we started by looking at Booleans, which just to go back, remember that is a true or false value. And we like Booleans because we want to do more than just be a glorified calculator for your physics assignments. We actually want to be able to write programs and do comparisons and only run certain pieces of code if a certain condition is met. And so in order to build up to that amount of control logic, we need to actually have a type that supports that. So that's the Booleans. And we use Booleans with propositions. So that's questions. So testing for equality is a question. It has a yes, no answer, i.e. true and false. So we have equals. We have less than, we have greater than, and less than or equal to, and greater than or equal to. And all five of those functions operate with numbers. Please don't try them with other things like strings and so on. But they do work with numbers. And all of those functions have a contract like this. They consume two numbers, and they are going to produce a Boolean result. Note that when we have a contract that is going to have a Boolean in it, we don't actually write the whole word Boolean out. We're lazy. Don't write that many characters. So we shorten it just to bool. That's fairly standard, actually. All right. Now, using these on their own is not that useful. I can test if something is equal, and I can return true or false. Great. But what if I am asking a more complicated question? Like, I want to know if X is both a multiple of 2 and a multiple of 9. I have two questions I'm connecting together that I want one final answer. Well, that's where the connectives and, or, and not actually come in handy. And Dr. Rackett actually has all three of these built in. And they do indeed let you connect multiple propositions together, as they've done so here. Remember that this is still being written in postfix notation. Now, interesting fact about and or in Racket is that they take more than two parameters. So mathematically, when we use and or, it takes two arguments. This and this, this or this. Well, Racket has and or take any number of arguments. What that means is that in order for and to produce true, every single argument passed to it must evaluate to true. And in order for or to produce true, at least one argument must evaluate to true. Not only actually takes the one argument and flips. All right. Now, an interesting thing about the and or functions in Racket. If we give some giant expression, actually, you know what? Let's just do this in Racket. That's more fun. Let's open up Racket. If I do something like this, and equals x4 equals, or even. There's a built-in function even, by the way, that checks if a number is even, x. And let's just say it's got a whole ton of these arguments. You might think, based on everything we've said so far about how Racket functions are evaluated, that in order to do the and, we have to evaluate every single one of the arguments first. And we can only actually and it all together once all of the arguments are values. And for and or, that is not true. We actually don't need to evaluate all the arguments all the time with and or. For example, it only takes one false argument for and to produce false. And so Racket actually has that shortcut built in. It will look at its arguments and it will evaluate them left to right, just as we would with canonical form. But the first argument it evaluates to false, it stops evaluating them and returns false because there's no other possibility. It only takes one false value in order for and to produce false. So it doesn't even matter what the other arguments evaluate to. It's irrelevant. And is going to produce false. And so when we are doing stepping with and, the first one that produces false, stop. Don't evaluate the remainder. The same is true for or, except it's a little different. With or, it takes at least one argument to evaluate to true for or to produce true. So or, it will still evaluate its arguments left to right. The first argument that produces true, and or stops. Because it doesn't matter what the remaining values are. We have one true value, therefore or is always going to produce true regardless of what the others are. Does that mean we're always going to be able to evaluate fewer than what's presented to us? No, because it may be that and takes 100 arguments and the first 99 all evaluate to true, but the last one is false. But it doesn't do any extra work than what it has to. And that's pretty useful. And by the way, most languages also do the same thing. Because why continue on with all that extra work if you don't have to? It would be like if you were in some kind of programming contest, you know, they have these hackathons. That's a very new thing to me. Didn't exist when I was going through undergrad. And let's say you show up to a hackathon and you code and you code and you code, it's like 16 hours straight and somebody wins. But you keep coding as if the contest is still on for the next 2 weeks. Why? It doesn't matter what you do. Somebody else has already won. So and or do the same thing. And that's pretty standard across many languages. All right. Now, let's go back to slides here. We can use these to do lots of fun things. But straight up, they're kind of ugly because they're just these expressions with no names. What I actually want to do is create my own questions. For example, maybe I want to write a function that determines whether you are eligible to play Breath of the Wild. And maybe the arguments to that function are your age, can you see? I don't know how you'd ever play that video game if you were not able to see. Can you read? Although I don't think that's really required. Things like that. So we check. We'd write our function. Can play Breath of the Wild? And we check, is your age greater than or equal to 5? And if so, and, because you have to be greater than or equal to 5, and you have to be able to see. So we're greater than or equal to 5. I presume you're all older than 5. And then we check, can you see? Oh, yes, you can see. And you can read, great. And you know something about what Zelda is. Maybe we're not going to let people play Zelda if they don't know what Zelda is. That's a pretty cruel rule, but we want to write a function to do this. That function has a name. It's called a predicate. And you can make your own predicates. And we encourage you to do that. So sometimes we might ask things like, is a number in a certain range? So we write a function between. And we pass it the low and high and our number, and then that's where we actually have our Boolean logic down there. Here's our expression. And now we can use these nice functions as questions of our own in other programs. It's really, really, really useful. And this is something that you're going to have to do on many of the assignments. On one of your assignments, you're going to be working with spheres. And we're going to ask you to write a predicate to test whether something is a valid sphere. They're very useful. Why are predicates useful? Well, if you didn't have predicates, if you didn't write some function that answers this yes-no question, then in whatever code is using that thing, we would have to put all of this logic again and repeatedly put it. If we make a function to just answer that yes-no question, then instead in all our other code having that long expression, I can just call the predicate and it gives me an answer, yes or no, true or false. Predicates are really important. Now, in this course, we have a specific format we'd like you to give the predicates as. And that is having their names end with a question mark. That puts it in your mind when you see a function that ends, its name ends with a question mark. This is a question. It gives me a true false answer. It's something that makes the code very readable. Now, if you're sitting there like, oh, but you can't have symbols in the name, C doesn't let you. Why would anybody let you do this? This is not C, this is not Java, this is Raka, and we certainly allow you to do that. And in fact, you can have arg parameter and constant names in Raka that will scare you. Lots of things are allowed that wouldn't be allowed in other languages. Generally speaking, keep your code nice and tidy, but there are valid uses for symbols like in predicates. Now, when you see me write predicates, I typically, I wouldn't write sphere question mark. I tend to be a bit more verbose and do is dash sphere, a little bit more wordy. That's up to you. As long as your predicate ends with the question mark, maybe. That's all we need. All right. Cool. But this is still not that interesting, really. It's really not. That's because every time I want to write some code, I have to evaluate everything. If you look at math, sometimes we use different expressions, different functions, depending on the value of our argument. And some of those functions are actually really simple. Something like computing the absolute value of a number, we use a different formula based on the value of the parameter. So, for absolute value, if x is less than 0, we multiply x by negative 1. But if x is greater than or equal to 0, we just produce x. So far, you don't have the ability to do that in Racket. Now, if you're using some language other than Racket, like C or C++, you absolutely have the ability to do that without with just what we've presented so far. But in Racket, we don't have the ability to do this yet. So how do we do it? We have a mathematical representation of it. It's called a conditional expression. And a conditional expression is a number of questions and answers. And they are evaluated top to bottom. We ask the first question. If it evaluates to true, we produce the value of the answer for that question. If the first question does not evaluate to true, we go to the next question. Does it evaluate to true? And if it doesn't evaluate to true, we just keep going down the list until we find one of them that actually evaluates to true, and then we produce whatever answer it is. So we can actually take that absolute and turn it into a conditional expression. So if x is less than 0, that's the question, I produce negative x. And if x is greater than or equal to 0, I produce x. Now, conditional expressions have a very specific format. And I believe your style guide is going to tell you all about how you should format these, so please do read it. Current statement has this format. Thank you. That's the format of hex. Now in this algorithm, you'll note that they use the square brackets and I have used the round brackets. I find the square bracket weird. They both work. Style guide says that you should use the square bracket. You should use the square bracket. I'll probably tell the TAs to be lenient about it because by default, I always use the round one. It's my marking scheme. I can do what I want. All right. Now, what's interesting about this format is this else. This is a catch-all. If none of these questions evaluate to true, this always evaluates to true. But this else is optional. You don't have to have it. Now, what's interesting, and in fact, this one here doesn't have it, but I can make it have one. And it's quite easy because if x is not less than 0, then x must be greater than or equal to 0. So I can get rid of that condition and shove an else there. There's no need to evaluate that expression. When you are working on conditions, conditional expressions, ask yourself, can I get rid of one of these cases and put an else in there? If you can, do so. You can only have one else, by the way. Why might you use an else? Okay. If you were to evaluate this on a sheet of paper, how many lines does it take when you have to evaluate this expression versus not evaluate the expression? Well, in this case here, it would just be one, but what if that was a nice compound expression? You'd be saving lots of lines, lots of steps. That means your computer would be doing less work. So else cases can actually save you time. Not just you typing code out, but it saves the computer time as well. And if you're doing the stacking on paper, it's going to save you steps. So always ask yourself, do I need an else? Could I use an else here? All right, so they give the format, by the way, on the following page. And let's actually do some experiments with it. So one of the functions that we could write is am I going to pass? Now I don't want it to return true or false, because if I wanted it to return true or false, I wouldn't actually need the con statement. I want to actually need the con statement, so this is actually the contract for my function is going to be. By the way, this is a really good example of why you shouldn't use super long function names. Who wants to type that crap? Not me. This is going to produce a string. And if you're not familiar with strings so far, don't worry about it. We are going to talk about them next class. All right, so am I going to pass is going to take your assignment grade and the assignment's weight. Oh no! If I keep typing, I'm going to get word wrap. What should I do? It's okay if you see yourself having a definition that takes more than one line to go to the next line. When you go to the next line, you might be tempted to start continuing writing your code right from there, like the leftmost edge. Don't do that, because then I don't know what the hell you're doing. Make the code line up. Watch where I line this up. Right underneath the other arguments. Like so. All right. Now I have my con statement. So, I could do this. So in order to pass the course, the weighted, if I need to multiply the assignment grade by the assignment weight and add that to the exam grade multiplied by the exam weight, and that has to be greater than or equal to 50. So this is going to get nasty. Now you note here again that in order to avoid word wrap, I've put the second argument for my plus under the first argument for the plus. It's very clear that even though those two arguments are on separate lines, that because they line up vertically, it's clear that these are arguments to the same function. Now, I could have put 50 on the previous line, but I chose not to because I find it kind of visually confusing when the parameter to the greater than or equal to function is on the same line with parameters that are just to the plus. So I like to kind of have them lined up vertically. That's just a personal preference of mine. All right. So if that evaluates to true, then what I'm going to do is print out this nice message will show up on the screen. Now, oops, I guess I forgot the close bracket. Number one source, by the way, of syntax errors in Racket is you forgot the brackets. Or you put them in the wrong spot. And if you go online and you're talking in like the Stack Overflow community or you're talking to some friends and you say, oh yeah, I'm learning Racket right now. They're gonna say, oh, you mean that language with all the brackets. Yeah. It has a bit of a reputation. So then I can do this, copy that over here, paste it down, except now I want it to be less than 50. And then we will do Lord of the Rings is on my mind because I just introduced my 5-year-old to it. She loves it because the Ents are awesome, right? All right, so there's my function. Run this little bit of code, and you know, now we can run some tests. We should have written the test first, but I was being a little lazy. Now, what did I name this function? Reason number like 8 million why you shouldn't give your functions really long names, because you'll forget actually what the name is. Now, if I get 0 in the course, and the assignments are worth 25%, and I get 0 on the exams, I should not pass the course. But if I get 100% on the assignments and 100% on the exams, which I hope is what happens to every single one of you, then you pass and everybody's happy, right? Now that's not enough tests, by the way, and we'll talk more about how to do tests with conditionals shortly. But this code isn't that great. If I come back and I actually look at this, do you see that I have, in my condition, repeated the same expression twice? If I'm greater than or equal to 50, do one thing, and if I'm less than 50, do something else. Well, if I'm not greater than or equal to 50, then obviously I'm less than 50. There was absolutely no need for me to repeat all that expression there. So I can simply replace all of this with an else. And we're done. That's pretty cool. Now, you gotta be careful. You gotta be real careful with conditions. It, depending on how you write your questions, it can really matter what order you ask them in. So if I write something like this, let's just do a simple function here. This function does nothing, by the way. So if x is less than 10, I want to multiply x by 2. If x is less than 5, I want to multiply x by 4, and else I'm just going to produce x. Okay? If I run magic with the number 2,
What value gets produced? How many of you say 4? How many of you say 8? How many of you say 2? Well, let's run it and find out. But wait a minute. That's not the answer. If you look at these conditions, it very clearly states that if x is less than 5, I should multiply it by 4. That did not, that 2 times 2 is not 8. Sorry, 2 times 4 is not 8. Wow, I'm doing some bad math. 2 times 4 should be 8, but for some reason we've got 4. So this doesn't make any sense. What happened? Well, what happened was we evaluated the questions top to bottom. So we evaluate the first question. The first question asks, is x less than 10? Is 2 less than 10? Obviously. That's the only one of these cases then we're actually going to evaluate. We stop evaluating them after we find the first question that evaluates to true. None of the other questions will ever get asked. So we go into the case x less than 10, we produce 2 times 2, we get result 4. That's not the right answer. Now you might be thinking, well, what are the ways that you can make it so it doesn't matter, because it does matter what order you ask them in this case, but you could make it so it doesn't matter what order the questions are asked in. I could say something along the lines of, well, x needs to be, I could say, and x or greater than or equal to x and 5. So x is greater than or equal to 5 and x is less than 10. Go in there. And if x is less than a 5, then do the second one. So that actually fixes it. So we're going to do magic 2. We get 8. Is there a better solution? Is there an easier way to fix this? Any thoughts? Change the order. Change the order. There was no need to do all of that. And in fact, you should avoid all of that whenever you can. All we actually had to do was change the order of these two things. So if I simply grab this line here, push that one down, make it all line up here nice. That's it. That's literally all I had to do. Reorder them. No problem. Why was it broken before? The problem that we had before was that the first question overlapped with the second question. So technically speaking, the first question was true, but so was the second one. But since the first question evaluated to true, we never even asked the second question. This, by the way, is not just a problem with Rapid. If you were programming in any other language, we don't have cont, but we do have an if statement, and it has the exact same problem. If the if expression, so if this true, do this, if you have those questions in the wrong order, you'll get an unexpected output. It's important that you put them in the right order. Now, how else can we use cond? Well, you might think this is the only place that you can use cond. Define a function to be a conti. Nope. Cond is a conditional expression. It's just an expression. You can put it anywhere you want. So I can do something like this. I can put the cond statement as an argument Why does it work? Because Racket will not evaluate the function. It doesn't apply plus until all of the arguments to plus are values, which means the conditional expression will be evaluated before we actually add.
So when I do this, since 4 is even, I end up having this whole thing here evaluates to 8, and then we add it to 2.
You can have even more fun with conj.
So, looking back at this function magic, maybe I don't want to specify my things in a specific order. Maybe I want to nest a condition inside a conditional expression. You can do that. You can nest them as deep as you want. So my answer for this cond question may be another cond. Yes, I know I wrote that all in one line. Don't do that. Do you know why you don't do that?
Well, number one, you're going to end up with word wrap. But number two, if there's a syntax error in there, since I have multiple expressions on the same line, how could I possibly know where the error is? It's not so bad in Racket, but if you move on to something like C and you do this, it's a nightmare. Don't do that.
That's just me being lazy. All right. So now when I do magic 2, I still get 8.
You can nest cons in other cons. You can even have a cond in the question part of a cond. Put them anywhere. Should you do it? Just because you can put them wherever you like doesn't mean you should. Just because I could put a peanut butter and jelly sandwich in my VCR doesn't mean I should do it. And the same goes here. There are very good reasons why we do nest conditional expressions, but it's very rare to see in this course. And in general, you should avoid doing the nasty things that I have just done. I have just abused some of the syntax of the Racket language and used it in a way that is not terribly readable. Don't worry, by the end of this course, I'll show you like 10 other ways to make really ugly Racket code that's actually kind of cool, but it doesn't mean you should do it. Cons are pretty powerful. Now you actually have the ability to do some real work. More than just your physics homework. All right. So we have an example of this actually in the notes. I'll let you read this example on your own. But just another example using the conditions needing a specific order is if you look at the mark that you achieve in this course, depending on what grade you get, is going to determine which course you go into next. So if you get less than 40% in this course, you have to take CS115. That's this course minus minus, so less work. If you get between 40 and 50, they say you should just take this course again. If you get between 50 and 60, they'll only let you move on to CS116, which is the Python course, which I've heard a lot of people wish they could take that one instead of 136. I understand why. And then if you get greater than 60%, you can take the CS major course, CS136, which we don't do Python in, but we do C. All right. So we want to get, write a function that is going to tell us which one of these courses we get to go in. So they define some constants. And then what they're going to do is they have a question for each of them. Now, technically speaking, they have this expression here, and that's extraneous. This check whether the grade is equal to, greater than or equal to 60. I don't need that, because if it's not any of the others, and you put a requirement in there that it can't be negative, then we could just use an else. And I mean, to be fair, if you got a negative score in this course, you did something very special, and maybe we should let you into 136. Maybe you'll get like 1,000% or something. Who knows? I don't know. You broke the system. All right. So, again, We've got these conditions, questions, and they have to be in a specific order. If I don't put them in a specific order, I'm going to run into problems. Now, in this case, because I've actually got the low end of the range and the high end of the range, they don't need to be in a specific order. But I have all this extra work. I don't want to do all that extra work. What I want to do is simplify it to that. When you simplify it to this, however, yes, this is much more efficient. The problem is now it really matters what order those questions are asked in. My recommendation to you is it may not always be obvious to you what the simplest form of the conditional expression is. Start with what you can do. Start with the verbose one. And then go back and look at your code and ask yourself, can I simplify what I have written? And then simplify it. This is something, by the way, that we don't expect you to be able to do off the top of your head, simplifying your code. This is something that comes with experience. Some people, it doesn't take them long to catch on. Other people I've seen after even like 30 or 40 years of programming, they still write code that's hideous. Start with what you can do and then ask yourself, how could I make it better? All right. Any questions about this here? So now that we have the conditional statements, we actually have the ability to do some more testing. So the tests that I've talked about so far, and all of the tests that you could have done for assignment one, would have been what's known as black box test cases. It didn't matter what the implementation of the function was. You were simply saying, for these particular arguments, do I get the expected value? That's a black box test case. Now that we have conditions, we actually have the ability to do white box test cases. White box test cases actually know about the implementation of the function and are written specifically to make sure that every part of the body of the function behaves exactly as it should. You need to see the code in order to do that. For condition statements, conditional expressions, you actually need to write a lot of white box tests. You need to write one test for every boundary condition. So the boundaries for the previous code is greater than or equal to 40, so you'd want to write a test for 40. Greater than or equal to 50 is a boundary, so you write a test for 50. Greater than or equal to 60 is a boundary, so you write for that. In addition to the boundary cases, you must also write one test that exists somewhere in the range for each question. You have to make sure that there is at least one input that will produce each one of these answers. You have to make sure that you can reach all of them. It's so common in code for people to write complex conditional expressions, and then when they run their program, there's a few questions that never even get asked, or a few answers that, because those questions would never ever evaluate to true, all of the code of that answer will never ever run. So it's garbage. Yeah?
So you say that you're gonna, in the contract, still test things like negative numbers if you've already tell them they're good natural numbers.
Okay, so the question is, if your contract says two natural numbers and produces a real number, do you need to actually test for negative numbers? No. So in that particular, so the only way that you would ever have to test for invalid input is if the question explicitly asked you to test that. And in a lot of cases, the contract might be written differently. So if we say consumes two nats and produces a num, then you can assume, unless we specify otherwise, that the input provided is going to be correct. Now, that's for this course. In the real world, when you are writing tests, you should assume the user is an idiot. And you should assume that they see the contract and they're like, ha ha! And they pass it a strength. Always assume the user's dumb. I mean, so to be fair, there's actually two schools of thoughts on that. One school of thought says, your code is correct, force the user to obey. And the other school says, assume the user's an idiot and clean up their mess. I'm actually in the assume the user does the right thing category, but when I write code, I assume the user's an idiot because I never know who's going to use my code. And I don't want to answer help questions on things I don't. All right, any other questions about this?
Okay. So for the record,
the tests that we need for this particular question, there are three boundaries. So there's 40, 50, and 60 are my three boundary cases. And then to test, to make sure that I can actually reach each of these, I've got 30, which is less than 40. I've got 45, which falls in between this one and this one, so it should go in here. And then I've got 55, which should cause us to go into this one, and then 70, which will cause us to go into this one. So we're testing to make sure that both all of the questions will actually, for some input, evaluate to true, but we're also testing to make sure that the boundary cases behave the way we expect them to. And you have to do both. So for this, you need 7 tests. Which actually brings me to the topic of why you should simplify your conditional expressions. If you have nested conditionals, excuse me, if you have really complicated con expressions, you might have to write 50 tests for a 6-line program. I don't think any of you want to do that. So my recommendation to you is try to simplify your conditional expressions as best you can. And that way, not only will you have a nice, tidy, efficient piece of code, but you'll also have a piece of code that you don't actually have to write as many tests for. But yes, a lot of tests are required when you have conditional expressions. And it's not just conditional expressions. We also need them for our Boolean expressions. So for ands, ors, and nots, and comparisons, you're also going to need, or sorry, not ands and ors, but your ands and ors, but not the less than. You also need to have tests for every option. So you need to have a test for when the first argument is true, and you need to have a test for when the first argument is false. You need to have a test for when the second argument is true, and a test for when the second argument is false. You need to have tests for every combination of true and false values. So that's actually a really good reason why you shouldn't have an AND expression with 300 arguments. Because I think that might be 300 arguments, what's that? That's 300 bits, so that's 2 to the power of 300 tests. Yeah, you might be here for the next 1,000 years writing those. So don't do that. Keep your code as simple as possible. And if you're sitting there and you're like, well, I don't know how to write it as simple as possible first off. No, relax. Write what you can do first. Come back and refine what you've done. Clean it up after. There's actually a real name for this. It's called refactoring. And people do that in industry. Some of my jobs, like the first day I had to do on them, was here's a program. Can you refactor it for us? That's how I both learn their software and get my first task done, and then I can actually write new code. So it's real important. All right, now we've already talked until your ears bled about black box and white box tests. I'm not gonna keep going there. Just one thing I wanna reiterate on. If you are reading the textbook, and I'm not gonna judge you one way or the other, but if you are reading it, you will note that it suggests that you should do your tests using the equals operator. Do not use the equals operator in this course for tests. We're going to take advantage of Dr. Rapp's teaching languages and the check, expect, check within, and check error functions. Please use the check expects in order to do your tests. Don't do it any other way. And if you do it the other way, yes, you will lose marks. All right. So, are there any questions about conditional expressions, tests for conditional expressions, Boolean expressions, anything like that? All right. So, a lot of the time I like to do my own examples, and I like to skip over the ones in the notes, that way you actually have more examples to study from. But this one that's actually in the notes is actually a really good example. So this is both going to show you how to design a program that's a little bit more complex than anything we've done so far, but the best and biggest takeaway from this particular example is it's a great example of refactoring code. And we're not going to be able to finish it today in all likelihood, but we'll start today and we'll see how far we get. So the test that we want to do, or the program that we want to write, is I want to write a program to compute how much taxes I'm going to need to pay this year. Now, you're all students, you still all have to file taxes and all of that, but because you're students, you probably don't have to pay any. Lucky you. Best part of being a student, right? No taxes. Unless you have like crazy billions of dollars in investments, in which case, yeah, your measly $30,000 of tuition won't really excuse you from much, but. So in Canada, taxes work interesting. So they don't just say, oh, you make $1 million, therefore you owe us 50% of your income. It's actually more of a, they use a tax bracket system. So if you make within a certain amount of money, yes, you will pay more taxes, but you're not going to pay that higher rate on the whole balance of what you've made. You only pay that amount on part of it. So whatever you make on up to 45,000, you'll pay 15%. So if you only made $6,000 this year, you'll pay 15% of that. If, however, you made $46,000, you will pay 15% on 45,000 plus 20% of whatever was left over. That's between 45 and 90. So you'll pay 20% of 1,000. Now if you made $95,000, you would pay 15% of the first 45, 20% of the next 45, and then 25% of the remainder. So it's this bracketed system. And if we actually, you get, draw it out, you get this piecewise curve. Now, if you are filing your taxes yourself, and I know that's coming up next month, please do not use the numbers from these slides. They're kind of close to the real lines, but they're very much rounded, and it's, doing your own taxes is far more complicated than this. All right. So we want to sit down and we want to actually write this program. But the mathematics behind this are a little bit more complicated than anything we've done so far. So I might actually, and I know if this was me sitting down to write this program, actually the first thing that I would do is I would actually start doing some examples on a piece of paper to figure out how does the math for this program have to work. And that's actually what they've done here as well. So they start by saying, okay, on a piece of paper, if I make $40,000, what's the taxes I'm going to pay? And they notice, okay, well, $40,000 is within the first bracket, so I pay 15%. So after they get that out, they will, on paper, they can write the example for it, the test for it. And then they try some other numbers. So they try 60,000. Well, 60,000 is greater than the first brackets boundary, which is 45, which means they're going to pay 15% of 45,000 plus 25% of the leftover. And the leftovers, because it's less than the next boundary, bracket boundary, is your income minus the 45,000 before. So you end up paying
and 97 feet. Now, if you made, and then we can make the appropriate test for it. And by the way, so long as you don't call your own function in the check expect, you're free to leave it as like a base math expression. I know you don't want to sit there with a calculator trying to figure this out. Just let Rackham handle it for you. Just don't use your function to compare your function to. That doesn't make any sense. For 100,000, that's in the third bracket. So I'm going to get 15% of the first 45,000, 20% of the second 45,000. Now note, because we are actually not in the second bracket, we are in the third bracket, we're subtracting the boundary from the previous boundary. And then I take 25% of my salary minus the amount I've paid taxes on so far, which is 90,000. We start to notice as we do these examples, there's a pattern here. And that's the reason why you should work these things out on paper first. Do your examples first, because as you're working out the math on paper, you'll see patterns. And those patterns you can translate into the code, the method that you need to do in order to solve this problem. And this is not just these slides telling you to do it. This is actually what I do in my own programs. Now, it used to be that I would do it all on paper, and I had stacks of paper, and my husband was like, seriously? There's like a stack of paper on every surface of our house. So he took my paper away and gave me a tablet. And now I have pages and pages of digital paper where literally everything I have coded in the last about 15 years, I drew it out, I did the samples, and I didn't even touch the code until I was 100% convinced I knew how to do it on paper. And in graphics, that's actually a lot of work. That means that like, I'm actually like drawing like pictures of spheres, and I'm sitting there trying to draw all these things. Okay, what if my vector goes this way and my vector goes that way? Yes, I actually do this. It's not just something I'm like ranting at you. It's something I actually do. And I really recommend it. You will have a much easier time on the assignments if you plan out on paper first. Where paper can be, you know, paper, toilet paper, scratch it in your car, I don't care. Plan it on something. All right. So now that I've got a really, really good feel for how the math in this needs to work for my examples, I can actually come and write my purpose and my contract and my header. I know what I'm going to do now. But, you know, before I start writing my code, I realize the fact that I've got a bunch of magic numbers in this function. I should have a bunch of constants. I have all of the different rates for each of the brackets. So for the first bracket, it's a 15% tax rate. For the second bracket, it's a 20%. If I actually wrote those values right into the function, well, tax percentages change every year, and that means every year I'd have to go and replace every single number. I want to do that. Make a constant. Give it a meaningful name. This isn't really a very good name. I didn't say the slides were perfect. Now, we also should make some constants to identify the barriers for each of those brackets. So that is the top value that you would fall into. So for the first bracket, 45,000 is the limit, the second is 90, the third is 150, and the fourth is 200,000. These are really bad names. BP1. I don't know what that means. I really don't. Please don't use names like that in your code. That has no meaning. I might say something like bracket maximum, or you have to find something that's meaningful. BP1 could mean, I don't know, isn't there like a BP gas company or something? Or it could mean bipolar disorder 1. I don't know what it means. Use something meaningful. All right. We've got our contract. We've got our examples. We got our examples for free. Because as we were doing the math on paper, we made examples that also helped us figure out what we had to do. So now I've got that, and I've got my constants. Now I can, well, wait a minute. You know, we could simplify it a little bit. So I could do something like, here's my rates. And then in each function, you know, I could have something like, okay, con, you know, pay is less than BP1. Then I would do something like, okay, reduce rate 1 times my pay. But then if I start doing something like, okay, well, if my pay is less than, do you see why the BP1 and BP2 doesn't make any sense? Like, what the hell is that? Then I have to do times rate 1, BP1, plus times, hey, I need a minus here, minus. Okay, BP1, rate 2. And then for the next one, I'm going to have to compute this all over again. And in fact, in each one of those conditional expressions, in each one of those answers, I'm going to be recomputing those values. Well, actually, maybe the tax rate, the maximum tax paid per bracket should be a constant. And so we can do that. So I could also make constants, in addition to having the rate and the brackets as constants, I could also have constants for these here, the base tax amounts for each bracket. So here's my base amount. Okay, so you're asking, so if we leave comments behind, can we name it whatever we want?
Yes.
No. Now, for assignment one, you're fine. Because in assignment one, you're dealing with a bunch of math and physics functions where it's x. What else are you going to call it? Right? Or gravitational constant is g. If you have something like a gravitational constant, whose name really is G, feel free to use G, but also leave a comment indicating that G is the gravitational constant. That's an exception. But if you have like some random function, like, well, even let's choose this, and you're gonna use the pay, you're just gonna use I, and then you say I is the pay, or I is your income. You know what? That's not so readable. I don't wanna have to find your comment to find what some obscure, not related to a actual constant in real life is. There are a few exceptions like the gravitational constant and the speed of light, but other than that, make sure they're very readable. You can still add comments, and in fact, that's something I would encourage all of you to do. As you start writing conditional expressions that are more and more complicated, I never see anybody in this course comment their code. Comment your code! Add extra comments. You have to have the design recipe, but you can add more comments. Comments will help you. All right, I'm going to leave it here, and we'll continue on with this next class. Oh.